You hear that? That's the sound of the game that spread 3 generations and across 18 games and 9 spin-offs. Now, come along with me as we learn about the legend of Zelda. The Legend of Zelda is a game franchise created by Shigeru Miyamoto, who also created games such as Mario, Star Fox, F-Zero, Donkey Kong, and Pikmin. Miyamoto would always explore the hills, forests, and caves of his hometown Shinobi in Japan. Together with longtime colleague and soon-to-be manager and producer of Zelda, Eiji Aonuma, as well as storyboard artist Takashi Tezuka, creator of Yoshi, they started work on a new game. The three creators worked on and on to make The Legend of what? No name being given to the princess yet, and none of the names being thrown around were final. That's when American novelist Scott Fitzgerald came to Miyamoto's mind. Or rather, Fitzgerald's wife, Zelda. Miyamoto thought of the name as pleasant and significant. Soon after, the princess and her game had a name. Of course, that's not all that inspired the franchise. Link and his fairy, along with Shadow Link, were inspired by the popular children's story, Peter Pan. Although Shadow Link's battle with Link was far more sinister than that of Peter and his shadow. And the Master Sword, Link's legendary blade, was inspired by the sword Excalibur. But what about Link? Why was this random name given to such a hero? Well, apparently, Link was supposed to collect digital chips, traveling between past and future to get them, therefore linking them together. Oh, come on! Are you telling me that the legendary hero's name was based off a cheesy pun all this time? Come on, Mr. Miyamoto. Ah well, all things aside, I can't say much more without first explaining a few things about the story of the games. The Legend of Zelda takes place in the land of Hyrule, which is generally inhabited by 4 races. The Zoras, fish-like creatures whose bodies resemble that of humans. The Gorons, heavyweight creatures who enjoy extreme heat and can roll up into boulder-like balls. The Gerudo, an all-female race of desert folk who have outlawed men, birthing only 1 male every 100 or so years. How unlucky though, is the Prince of Darkness himself. And finally, the Hylians, elf-like people who populate the land of Hyrule, with their castle usually towering in the center of the land. Of course, there are some game-specific races such as the bird-like Rito, descendants of the Zora, the Kokiri, or Children of the Forest, and their seed-like descendants, the Koroks, the Tiny Minish, and the watching you while you sleep and enjoying it, Ukas. Even their music is unsettling. These Ukas were rumored to have close relations to the ancient kingdom of Hyrule. They also have a large technological advancement in terms of their city, which is floating in the sky. These creatures are seen living in this city in the sky, in The Legend of Zelda Twilight Princess, released November 19th, 2006. But that wasn't the only civilization that was hidden above the clouds. Let's turn our heads to the first Hylians, who were sent away by the goddess Hylia from a dying land, the resting place of the first hero and later the site of the creation of the Master Sword. Let's go back hundreds of years to the first game in the timeline, to the Forgotten Land, and then skyward to the small town of Skyloft, home of the Skyward Sword. Released on November 18th, 2011 for the Wii, Skyward Sword was the first game in the Zelda timeline. In this particular legend, the original Demon King, Demise, has attacked the land of Hyrule in order to obtain the full Triforce, a legendary gift by the gods of power, wisdom, and courage. When Demise attacked, the goddess Hylia was ready with an army to protect her land, but even with the help of the first Link, who was only being shown in the manga for the series, the goddess could not stop the growing evil. In a last-ditch effort to save her people, Hylia gathered all of the Hylians onto a piece of land and sent them above the clouds. Though not everyone could escape, and the hero Link was left to die. The goddess Hylia stayed behind, and as her troops fought, she promised Link that they would meet another time in another life, casting a spell that would change the destiny of Hyrule forever. Now, with everything falling apart, the goddess used the last of her power to seal Demise away so he could never hurt her people again. Years later, after the creatures of the surface and the people in the sky have long forgotten each other, a student at the Night Academy, Link, who has just lost his oldest friend, Zelda, who is actually the reincarnate of the goddess, to a hurricane that pulled her below the cloud cover, follows a mysterious figure around Skyloft until he finds a sword known as the Goddess Sword, underneath the statue of the goddess Hylia. The figure turns out to be Fi, the spirit in the sword, whose sole purpose is to aid the legendary hero in defeating Demise in case he were ever to be set free. Now with a way to get through the cloud cover below, Link and Fi set off to save Zelda, but they are not the only ones looking for her, as they encounter Ghirahim, a flamboyant man with magical powers who wants to use Zelda to break the seal that holds his master, Demise, at bay. This is not the only time they see Ghirahim, as they meet this creepy but great character a number of times. Throughout the journey, Link has to fight a beast known as the Imprisoned, who is held under the sealed grounds, the crater left by the bottom of the Isle of the Goddess, or Skyloft as it is called when it ascended, by a magical spike. It will continuously try to escape the crater, so it's Link's job to stop it each time. Eventually, Ghirahim manages to use Zelda's soul to resurrect Demise and free him from his form as the Imprisoned, while Link prepares to fight Demise with his newly formed Master Sword, created from the essence of the Goddess Sword bathed in the three sacred flames. Demise reveals that Ghirahim is actually his sword, and he traps Ghirahim into the blade. Link and Demise face off in the ultimate battle, but ultimately Link wins. In his final words before he is sealed away in the Master Sword, Demise acknowledges defeat and says to Link, "Extraordinary. You stand as a paragon of your kind, human. You fight like no man or demon I have ever known. Though this is not the end, my hate never perishes. It is born anew in a cycle with no end. I will rise again. Those like you, those who share the blood of the goddess and the spirit of the hero, they are eternally bound to this curse. An incarnation of my hatred shall ever follow your kind, dooming them to wander a blood-soaked sea of darkness for all time." So, who set the cycle in motion? Was it Hylia, with her promise to Link that they would meet again? Or was it Demise, with his curse to bind the three of them to an eternal cycle of pain? Who knows? For all I know, it could be—
So, wait. It's called The Legend of Zelda, but you play as Link? Isn't that a little unfair to him?
No, majority of people who don't understand The Legend of Zelda. It is not, because Zelda is the incarnate of the goddess Hylia. She has the sealing powers to stop the great evil. Link is just the swordsman who must protect her from the great evil until she can stop it.
But you said Link sealed Demise away with the Master Sword.
But who created the goddess sword? The goddess Hylia. And what was the Master Sword? The goddess sword. In fact, there's only been 3 games of all 18 mainstream Zelda games where Link has not used a weapon made by the goddess Hylia or fought alongside Zelda. So, what was this weapon? Who made it? You see, it all begins in the second game in the timeline. So hold on to your hats as we take a closer look into the world of The Minish Cap. The Minish Cap was a game released on November 4th, 2004 for the Game Boy Advance. It takes place in a Hyrule unlike the last one where Link, a young child, is picked to go ask the Tiny Minish, or as the Hylians call them, Bakori, for their help against the evil sorcerer of Vitae. Oh yeah, you also get this hat named Ezlo, who is actually a Minish along with Vitae, but they're both Hylian size. There's some weird stuff. A blade known as the Bakori blade breaks, and Link gets to make it into the Four Sword, splitting himself into four, and defeating Vitae. That's it. I know, super boring, right? If it weren't for the adorable Minish, this might be the worst Zelda game. Overall, though, the shrinking feature is pretty cool since you can shift between small and normal. There's also Four Swords, released December 2nd, 2002 for the Game Boy Advance as a multiplayer game. Four Swords had a nice design, the best great fairies, and Vitae is resurrected, but nothing special. But you know what is special? Ocarina of Time! On November 21st, 1998, 2 years after the debut of the Nintendo 64, The Legend of Zelda Ocarina of Time was released. This featured the first Z target lock, allowing backflips, sidesteps, jabs, and blocks. In this game, a young Kokiri boy named Link is the only child in the forest without a fairy. Therefore, everyone else teases him. One day, an ancient sentient tree named the Deku Tree sends the fairy Navi, who has a love interest for Link, according to Wikipedia, to Link. She tells him that she is his new fairy with a bunch of,
hey
listens, and hellos,
hey,
with a side of, watch out,
hello.
And he must go talk to the Deku Tree. The Deku Tree tells Link that he has sensed a great evil within him, so Link ventures inside to face the evil. Here Link finds Goma, a parasitic spider queen who is infecting the tree. When Link defeats Goma, the Deku Tree tells Link about the three golden goddesses. Din, goddess of power, Nehru, goddess of wisdom, and Farrar, goddess of courage. The Deku Tree explains that they created the land of Hyrule in the Triforce, an ancient relic split into three parts. Once the Triforce is assembled, the one who wields it will get one wish, and he believes it is hidden in a place called the Sacred Realm. He tells Link and Navi to go to Hyrule Castle to meet the Princess of Destiny. The Deku Tree entrusts Link with the Kokiri Emerald, and as the curse takes hold, the Deku Tree dies. Following this, Link meets his friend Seria, who gives him her fairy ocarina. Then Link and Navi set off to Hyrule Castle. At the castle, Link finds Princess Zelda, who is suspicious about the stranger meeting with her father, saying she had a dream that warned her about him. Zelda says the stranger's name is Ganondorf, and that he must want the Triforce for himself. Link goes to Death Mountain, home of the Gorons, to retrieve the Goron's ruby, and finds he must fight King Dodongo inside Dodongo Cavern. He later fights Baron Aid inside of a huge fish named Lord Jabu Jabu, who has accidentally eaten the Zora Princess Ruto. Jeez, what's with this game enforcing Link to crawl into the mouths of magical beings? As a token of thanks and an offer of engagement, the princess gives Link the Zora's Sapphire after he agrees to marry her. Along the way, he also goes to Lon Lon Ranch and meets Malon, who teaches him Epona's song, allowing him to call Epona for him to ride at any time. Link then goes to Kakariko Village, home of the Kukos, which you don't want to hit.
Why would you hit them?
How about you grab a weapon and a Kuko and see what happens?
Okay.
Kakariko doesn't own cold Kukos, though, but we'll get to that later. On his way back to Hyrule Castle, Link sees Zelda and her bodyguard Impa ride away on horseback. Zelda tosses the Ocarina of Time to Link, and soon after, Ganondorf chases her away. With the three stones that Link has collected, he is able to open a secret chamber in the Temple of Time, which resides in Hyrule Castle Town. In this room is the Master Sword. As Link pulls it from its pedestal, he enters a deep slumber. But with the Master Sword gone, the gates to the Sacred Realm are open, and Ganondorf steals the Triforce. But that's not all. When Link pulled the Master Sword from its pedestal, he was too young to wield it, so he entered a slumber for 7 years. Now he awakes in the Sacred Realm, where he meets Raru, Sage of Light. Raru explains that the reason Link is an adult instead of still a kid like a Kokiri is because he's actually Hylian, and he must find the other sages in order to defeat Ganondorf. He sets off to find the sages, and along the way, Link meets Sheik, a member of the mysterious Sheikah, who also have a torture dungeon under Kakariko. Sheik teaches Link many songs using his harp, each one involving the upcoming dungeon. The order in which you meet the sages is Seria, Sage of Forest, Darunia, Sage of Fire, Princess Rudo, Sage of Water, Impa, Sage of Shadow, Naburu, Sage of Spirit, and finally, Zelda, the leader of the sages. Somewhere along the way, Sheik reveals that he is in fact Zelda, but Zelda reveals herself too soon and Ganondorf caught her. Now Link and Navi set off to Hyrule Castle, where Ganondorf resides. Link beats Ganondorf and frees Zelda from her magical prison, only to have to escape Ganondorf's castle as it collapses. Then, when all is thought to be over, Ganondorf rises from the rubble, brandishes his Triforce of Power, and becomes Ganon. Link, Navi, and the seven sages manage to beat Ganon and seal him away into the Sacred Realm. Afterwards, Zelda then offers Link a choice. Go back to his original time and live his life normally, or remain an adult and live his life 7 years older than he is supposed to be. This is where the timeline splits into three: the Fallen Hero timeline, the Adult timeline, and finally the Child timeline. This timeline is the one we'll focus on first. Link wakes up in the Temple of Time, moments before he pulls the Master Sword and enters his 7-year slumber in the Sacred Realm. But not all is happy, as Link goes to the Lost Woods to look for Navi, who flew away after the credits rolled. That brings us to Majora's Mask, released April 27, 2000. Majora's Mask was the sequel to Ocarina of Time. It finds Link riding through the Lost Woods until he is stopped by a Skull Kid. For those of you who don't know, Skull Kids are the souls of lost children in the forest. Meanwhile, adults who are lost become Skullfolks. But this Skull Kid is wearing some sort of mask and has two fairy friends, Tattle and Tail. The Skull Kid steals Link's horse, Epona, and his Ocarina of Time. As Skull Kid escapes, he accidentally leaves Tattle behind, and she tells Link to get her back to her friend. But when Link finds Skull Kid, he is turned into a Deku Skull, and him and Tattle continue their chase. That brings them to the land of Termina, in a town called Clock Town, where Link meets the Happy Mask salesman, who says to return back to being a Hylian, Link must get his ocarina back with the famous, "You've met with a terrible fate, haven't you?" line. He also says that Link must get his mask for him, the one that Skull Kid stole, and that Link must retrieve it soon because the Happy Mask salesman must leave in 3 days. So the timer begins, and Link quickly notices that the moon is very close to the ground, and according to some of the townspeople, the moon will fall in 3 days. On the final day, Link manages to get his Ocarina of Time back, and learns that Skull Kid is the one pulling the moon closer. With 5 minutes left, Link plays the Song of Time and goes back 3 days, meeting the Happy Mask salesman again, and learning that he is aware of the fact they have met before, asking for his mask and shaking him violently. The Happy Mask salesman plays a song for Link on a giant piano. This is the Song of Healing, which heals evil and turns troubled spirits into masks. When Link plays it, he turns back into a Hylian, dropping the Deku Mask in front of him. When Link lets the Happy Mask salesman know that he was unable to retrieve the stolen mask, the Happy Mask salesman breaks into a nervous fit of anger, telling Link that the mask was in fact the Majora's Mask, an evil mask used by an ancient tribe for hexing rituals. He says it holds great evil and will give a wicked power to the one who wears it. To stop Skull Kid from destroying Termina, Link and Tattle journey the land to find the four giants who can hold the moon up. They journey first to the Southern Swamp, home of the Deku Scrubs, then to the Great Bay, home of the Zoras, where Link gets the Zora's Mask. Following this, they travel to Snowhead Mountain, home of the Gorons, where Link gets the Goron's Mask, and finally to Ikana Valley, the site of a never-ending war and home of the Garo, all the while meeting many characters along the way. Each of these characters has their own story, and each their own ways of dealing with their fate. This sad tale of impending doom repeating itself over and over in a 3-day cycle is what makes this game so great. Every time you forget to travel back and get swallowed up by the moon, you're greeted with the words Link first heard when he met the Happy Mask salesman. "You've met with a terrible fate, haven't you?" These words showing that no matter what you do, somehow a terrible fate will come. Even after fighting the Majora's Mask itself, after it has discarded the body of the Skull Kid, even after the Land of Termina is saved, and the Happy Mask Salesman has gotten his mask back, not everyone is spared, as Link wanders the Lost Woods forever searching for Navi, never to see her again, marking the conclusion of Majora's Mask. In the next game of the timeline, Twilight Princess, released November 19th, 2006 for the Wii and GameCube, a young cattle farmer from Ordon Village, also named Link, is brought into a separate dimension known as the Twilight Realm by a Twi'li, a resident of this dimension. Unlike normal Hylians, who become ghosts unaware of their transformation, Link becomes a wolf. This wolf Link is imprisoned in Hyrule Castle, which has been corrupted by the Twilight Realm, until he meets Midna, a Twi'li who wants to overthrow the Twi'li King's Hand. Along his journey to collect the three fused shadows to help Midna achieve her goal, Link meets the hero Shade, who teaches Link numerous combat-related moves in Link's mind. This hero Shade appears as a Stealthos, who, as it turns out, is Link after Majora's Mask, who is regretful that he was never remembered for how he saved Hyrule, and wants this Link to carry on the legacy that he never fulfilled. Link goes on to fight Xant, and his master, Ganondorf, who is controlling Xant from the shadows. Midna even turns out to be the true princess of the Twi'li, while Xant is not royalty, meaning that she is the Twilight Princess. There are also some interesting bosses and stuff, like Stalord. You see, the idea of this battle is amazing. But these aren't the only interesting parts of the game. For example, Xant's mouth has slits on it so you can never tell what his emotions are. Or how this kid named Mallow from Ordon Village has his own shop with delightful music that just makes you want to escape, but you can't! Also, Death Sword. Nexus Four Swords Adventures. It was released on March 18th, 2004 for the GameCube as a four-player game and was Four Swords of Ganon. Next, the adult timeline, starting off with the Wind Waker, which is inspired after Yoshiki Haruhana drew a cartoon Link, released December 13th, 2002 for the GameCube. This legend starts hundreds of years after Link has returned to his child timeline, after he wasn't there to stop Ganon from returning. But because no one could stop Ganon, the gods flooded Hyrule, hiding away the Triforce underneath the ocean. Now, Link, a boy from Outset Island, has lost his sister to Ganondorf, the same Ganondorf who is in Ocarina of Time. So Link courageously sets sail with a bunch of pirates and their captain Tetra to save his sister. Along the way, Link meets the King of Red Lions, a talking boat who wants to stop Ganondorf and gives Link the magical Wind Waker. Link travels to Dragon Roost Island, home of the Rito. You know, the birds? Who are the fish? They're now the birds because Hyrule is now 90% water. Where Link meets Medli, the soon-to-be Sage of Earth. Link then goes to meet the Koroks, who used to be Kokiri. One of these Koroks is Makar, the soon-to-be Sage of Winds. Both Medli and Makar end up helping Link to restore a broken Master Sword. Once the Master Sword is restored and Link has found the Triforce of Courage underneath the waves, and after learning that Tetra is actually Zelda, Link descends down to Hyrule Castle, a place frozen in time by the gods. There, Link and Zelda face off against Ganondorf, who steals their Triforces of Courage and Wisdom, combining them with his Triforce of Power. Now Ganondorf wishes Hyrule to be deflooded and for him to become ruler. But his wish takes too long, as the King of Red Lions, or rather, his true form, the King of Hyrule, wishes for Hyrule to flood and for the Curse of Rebirth to end. Now having what he has been searching for the last 100 years taken away, Ganondorf laughs. He laughs at the world, at Link, and at Zelda. He laughs, then swears that he will not go down without a fight. And the final fight goes down as the remains of Hyrule flood, and Ganondorf is finally defeated. That brings us to Phantom Hourglass, which was released June 23rd, 2007 for the Nintendo DS. After the events of Wind Waker, Link and Tetra set off to find a new land. And for time reasons, that's all I'm gonna say. and finally, the last game of the adult timeline, Spirit Tracks, released on December 7th, 2009. Spirit Tracks takes place in New Hyrule, where a tower known as the Spirit Tower resides. Feeding all of the Spirit Tower are Spirit Tracks, which serve as chains to hold back the evil Maladus. Zelda becomes a ghost, then with her body back, charges up her power and weakens the freed Maladus, allowing Link to beat him. That's the end of the adult era. Now the downfall era, starting with A Link to the Past, released November 21st, 1991 for the Super Nintendo. Like Ocarina of Time, this was once considered the best Zelda game. It starts with a young Link who hears Zelda calling to him in a dream, so he goes to save her at Hyrule Castle, where she's been captured by the evil Aghanim, who wants to free Ganon out of the Sacred Realm. Link saves Zelda and goes on to stop Aghanim, and once he is defeated, Link travels to the Dark World, where the Sacred Realm as it once was. Link faces off against Ganon and wins. This is the last game of the series to feature non-linear dungeons until Breath of the Wild. Now that Link has beaten Ganon, he has the Triforce that Ganon tried to assemble, and he wishes for good to be restored. Next is the Game Boy Color game, The Legend of Zelda, Oracle of Seasons, and Oracle of Ages, released February 27th, 2001. This game has a lovely art style when it comes to the designs of the characters, and has the best Link in my opinion. Afterward, Link sets sail to try to get back to Hyrule, only to lose his way in a storm in the start of Link's Awakening, released June 6, 1993, for the Game Boy. Link washes up on the island of Koholint, and the only way off is to wake the sleeping windfish. Link eventually wakes the windfish, and it turns out Koholint was all just a dream of the windfish. As the island vanishes, Link tries to ignore the fact that he destroyed the island of Koholint and all its people. With no trace of the island even existing, except for what Link remembers, he sets off back to Hyrule, never to be seen again. Next is A Link Between Worlds, which has the same amazing art style as the Oracle games. It was released November 22nd, 2013, for the 3DS. It's interesting, but not interesting enough. Next is Triforce Heroes, released October 22nd, 2015 for the 3DS, as a multiplayer game. It takes place in Hytopia, a land obsessed with fashion, where the evil lady curses Princess Styla to wear an irremovable brown jumpsuit. The king calls three heroes to stop the lady and remove the curse on his daughter. Link from A Link Between Worlds and two others also named Link answer the call. I don't know much about this game, but it is super fun to look at, with its fun costumes, silly but cooperative main cast, and the best Link variation, Totem Link. I just love these guys, they're amazing. Years later, in the land of Hyrule once more, a young prince becomes king after his father dies. The new king's advisor, a wizard, says he believes the king's sister Zelda is responsible. When she denies the false claim, the wizard gets angry and curses her to an eternal slumber. Now, after the princess has been sleeping for years in the North Palace, a young adventurer named Link travels around Hyrule to collect the pieces of the Triforce and defeat Ganon in The Legend of Zelda, released for the NES on February 21st, 1986. This game was the first Zelda game, and it sprouted many famous things, including the line, "It's dangerous to go alone. Take this." Next, after Link has defeated Ganon, he goes to reassemble the Triforce and wake up the slumbering princess, which he does in The Adventure of Link, released January 14th, 1987 for the NES. It is the only 2D platformer of Zelda, and has Shadow Link. That's it. Now, let's all look towards the latest Zelda game, because I don't want to talk about the spin-off games, like Link's Crossbow Training, Tingle's Freshly Picked Rosy Rupee Land, Tingle's Balloon Trip of Love, Hyrule Warriors, Hyrule Warriors Legends, the CDI games, and the cartoon. No, let's end off on a good note. Let's explore the vast world of Breath of the Wild in as little time as possible, which apparently is 29 minutes. Alright. Breath of the Wild was released on March 3rd, 2017 for the Nintendo Switch and Wii U. This game starts off with Link waking up in a chamber with no memories. He receives something that resembles an iPhone and meets an old man. The old man tells him to go around to the forest shrines around the area and that he claims is called the Great Plateau. In this area, there is also the ruined Temple of Time. In fact, as Link continues to explore around the plateau, he notices everything has an odd untouched aspect to it. It's almost peaceful. When Link completes all the trials of the four shrines and gets new apps on his device, a tower rises from the ground. At the top, Link scans his device and gets a view of the map of the Great Plateau. The old man says to meet him at the top of the Temple of Time. There he reveals his true form as the dead king boss Varamus Hyrule, pointing toward the evil that seems to be resonating from Hyrule Castle. He tells Link that that evil is Calamity Ganon, the embodiment of Ganon's pure evil, and that 100,000 years prior, it was stopped by colossal machines. So 100 years ago, the Hylians dug up these four machines and labeled them as divine beasts, each with their own champion to pilot them. And along with them were many smaller machines known as the Guardians. The king talks of how the machines were made by the ancient Sheikah tribe, and that 100 years ago, Calamity Ganon came, took over the Guardians and the Divine Beasts, trapping the champions inside. It was then that Link fell in battle, but luckily he was brought to the Shrine of Resurrection, where he slept and healed for 100 years. Now Link must save Hyrule before Princess Zelda's magic runs out and the Calamity can fully escape and destroy the world. Link visits the four tribes to regain his memory. He goes first to the Rito tribe, bird-like people whose champion was Revali. Link ventures into their divine beast, Vametto, where Link frees Revali's spirit and gains Revali's gale. Link next goes to the Gerudo tribe, whose champion was Urbosa, a Gerudo capable of controlling lightning. Link boards the divine beast Vanaboris and manages to free Urbosa's spirit and gain Urbosa's fury. Next, Link ventures to Zora's domain, home of the best designed characters of Zelda. Look at them! They're so great! Look at Prince Sidon! You can literally join a fan club about him! The Zoras also had the best champion, Princess Mipha, who's going to propose to Link after they beat the Calamity. I feel so bad for her. Also, that would be the second time Link would be engaged to a fish. She had the ability to heal people and called her ability Mipha's Grace, which Link receives after he frees her spirit from inside Varuta. Finally, Link goes to Death Mountain to visit the Gorons, whose champion was Daruk. Daruk had the ability to make a shield around himself, which he decided to call Daruk's Protection. Link gets this ability after he frees Daruk's spirit from the evil Varudinia. Link finally goes to see the Great Deku Tree and his Koroks, who give Link the Master Sword. Before I finish off, I'd like to say that this game is full of references that are much more subtle than "now you're literally playing the original game!" Like how if you translate the Hylian markings on the markers you can place around the map, it says, "it's dangerous to go alone." Or how there's an NPC dedicated to Robin Williams who named his daughter Zelda. Or my favorite of them all, if you play the Dragon Roost theme from The Wind Waker and the Rito Village theme, there are some key similarities. Now, Link advances through Calamity Ganon's army, slicing his forces away with the sword that seals the darkness. Clad in his champion's tunic, Link brandishes his blade in front of the Calamity. The champions take aim with their reclaimed divine beasts and fire a devastating shot at the Calamity. Link and Ganon face off, first in close combat, then Link using the Bowl of Light given to him by Zelda to defeat Ganon on horseback. The fight rages on, with the forces of courage and power battling out for the possession of Hyrule. Good versus evil, hero versus villain, light versus dark, centuries of fighting leading up to this final moment. As Zelda steps forward, and with the full force of the goddess Hylia, she envelops the Calamity with a binding light, and Hyrule is safe one more. But is this the end? Only time will tell, as the legend unfolds.